owner and founder of lifecoach.com. Her clients include executives, professionals, public officials, entrepreneurs, and international leaders. Talane is the author of three books, All McGraw-Hill, and she'll speak about those in a bit. One of the most widely recognized life coaches in the world, Talane has been featured in numerous magazines from Newsweek to Fortune and has appeared on national and international television and radio programs, including the BBC and CBS Saturday Morning. Prior to becoming a coach, Talane held a corporate position as second vice president at Chase Bank in New York City. She graduated from the School of Foreign Service in 1987 and received her graduate degree in 1989. So Talane, thank you so much for being with us today. I'll now turn it over to you.
Great. Thanks so much, Sarah. Appreciate the invitation to talk about writing a book. So this is really a fun topic for me. Although my business is in coaching, I've written three books, so I'll talk to you a little bit about that process and share what I've learned about the publishing process with you and the hopes of inspiring you to get your own book written and published. But before we do that, can I ask you a couple of questions? Because webinars are sort of a bit of a one-way street with me doing most of the talking, unfortunately. But I really want to know about all your questions, so do send those in. But we want to find out a little bit before. Have you attended one of my webinars before? So if you could just answer that polling question, yes or no, and go ahead and vote.
All right.
Just find out who's in the audience.
Thank you. And we really appreciate you joining us on a July afternoon, too. I know some of you might be on vacation. Hopefully you are. But okay, looks like almost everyone has voted. So 86% of folks have not joined one of your webinars before, Talane, and 14% have.
Okay, great. Well, gosh, all sorts of new folks today. So welcome, all the new folks, and I hope you enjoy it. And again, a hearty welcome to those who've been on one before, and I'm glad you're coming back. So looks like we've hit a topic with a new chord. The next question here is, have you ever worked with a business coach, life coach, or executive coach before? So we're looking to find out if you know what coaching is about or if you've experienced that yourself. That's my business. I'm always curious about that.
Okay, almost everyone has voted. And by the way, that picture in the background is of the hilltop on the 4th of July. I thought I'd give everyone a little preview of what that looks like. But okay, we'll go ahead and close that out in case anyone was wondering. So 79% have not worked with any type of coach before, and 21% have.
So okay, we'll talk great.
In a little bit about what a coach, working with a coach is like. And the last question, where are you in the writing process? We'd like to know, are you thinking about your book idea right now? Are you actively writing a book? Do you have a finished product and now are looking for the publisher? Are you already working with a publisher? Or have you already published a book and now you're just moving on to the next one and curious what Talane's advice is? So almost everyone has voted. Thank you. Okay, so it looks like most of the people here are thinking about a book idea. 62% are still in the idea phase. 28% are actively writing. 7% have a finished product. And 3% have already published a book before. So most folks are here to generate ideas. So great. We're so glad you're here.
Wow, that's great. All right. Well, that actually is a really helpful start. So great. Well, thanks so much. Because that gives me a little bit of a focus on what to talk about today as well and where you guys are in the process. So that helps. Let's just start briefly tell you, since so few of you have actually worked with a coach, it's really fun having a coach. Coaching is distinct from consulting. Consultants tend to have a basis of knowledge in a particular field or an area of expertise, and you hire a consultant specifically because of that knowledge or experience. So in a sense, as a coach, if you hired me, for example, to help you get through the book publishing and writing process, that would be almost more consulting than coaching. Of course, I would bring my coaching skills to it, which would be the encouragement, the motivation, and helping you tap into your own motivation and working through blocks. So that's sort of the coaching piece. The consulting piece would be, here's how publishing works, here's how you might go ahead and doing that. It's more the information. So consulting is more information-based, whereas coaching is not necessarily reliant on having the information. Coaching is not therapy, so typically we don't deal with unresolved issues from the past. That's usually the realm of therapy. If I can get somebody unstuck from a past issue in 5 minutes, great. If not, we move them on to therapy for that. They're a therapist who are now moving into coaching, so that is starting to get a little bit blurred. The life coaching that we do is really the most similar to sports coaching. If you have ever had a personal trainer at the gym or a sports coach, they egg you on, they motivate you, they make you work harder than you would on your own, and usually get better results, and they keep you focused and prevent you from hurting yourself or going too far wrong. And coaching is more like that. We'll try to prevent you from making any big mistakes, give you encouragement, and keep you moving when you're ready to quit. Because writing and the publishing process is one geared up for a lot of rejection and frustration. So it's really nice to have somebody who can stay in the sidelines and say, keep going, don't give up hope. Particularly for writing, because that can be fraught with all sorts of disaster. So yeah, that's what life coaching is. Getting people on the path to financial independence, whatever your goals might be. All right, so let's go through the outline for today. How to get started writing your first book. So a lot of you are thinking, and so that's great. Actually, that is the first step, is thinking, having some sort of idea of what you want to write. And the next step is to start writing. So we'll talk about how you can do that. We'll talk a little bit about how to get the right title, which is really important, particularly for a nonfiction book, and we'll talk about why that's more important than for a fiction book. We'll talk about writing a book proposal, which is what you need to do if you're going to find an agent, and then from finding an agent, how to choose your agent, and then find a publisher, and then we'll talk a little bit about self-publishing. I have not self-published a book, but I have done an audio, so I can tell you a little bit about that if that's helpful. So I don't know so much about self-publishing. But I do know a little tiny bit, so hopefully I can get you started with that. All right, so that's what we're going to talk about today. And our next slide should be about the getting started. So for those of you in the thinking stage, that's a great place to be. And some people might be reading books for doing some research on their topic. I think of the Memoirs of a Geisha, the guy spent 14 years, I understand, doing the research for that book, and then wrote it and became a bestseller. So you may be in the researching phase, and that could take a lot of time, and it doesn't mean it's not worth doing, so don't lose heart. Researching, reading other books, reading other authors in that area, that's all an important part of the writing process. So you know, go ahead and do that. So you start thinking, even moving your thinking into doing some more research on your topic. You'll need to know what the other books are in the field anyway to write your proposal. So it's all part of the process to read what other authors have written and get their books and tag them and study them so that your book can be different, because you want your book to provide a different perspective on things, a different angle than what's already out there. And your publishers are going to want to know, and this is how nonfiction is different than fiction. Publishers want to know what you're going to talk about before you've written the book. So that's kind of the good news. You don't have to start writing the book first. In a way, you do have to write a couple of chapters, but you don't have to write the whole book in nonfiction. You can usually get away with 3 chapters and an outline. So from the thinking stage, we want to start doing some researching. But more important at this point is to start tapping into your creative side. Now, I don't know if any of you are actually already writers or creative people, but I was working in the bank when I was writing my first book. And banking is not really a creative field. So if you're in a field that's a corporate work world and it's taking most of your time and energy and it's not particularly a creative field, you may actually need to start nourishing your creative self. And the book that got me started with that is it Sandra Cameron? I'm sorry, I think Cameron's her name. And it's about tapping into the creative side of you by going to 2 things from her book that I found most helpful were Morning Pages and The Artist's Date. In fact, those are the only 2 things I used from her book. There's other good stuff in there. It's called The Artist's Way. And is it Julia Cameron? It's Julia Cameron, in the Artist's Way. So if you don't have that book and you feel creatively a bit stifled, I actually recommend hers for that, because it's a really lovely book on creativity. The two pieces that I really liked from that, the morning pages, she said write 3 pages a day regardless. So you could wake up in the morning, or you could do this at night. I often did it at night right before bed, and I just write about what happened during the day. I wasn't writing about my topic or my book, just a journal sort of, I had scrambled eggs for breakfast, that kind of thing. The point here is to start getting into the habit of writing. And I would do it longhand in a journal, but you could actually do that in a computer if that's your preference. But whatever tool is your preference. 3 pages a day. So if you want to write a book and are in the thinking stage, this next step for you of writing 3 pages a day, and literally scrambled eggs for breakfast, that's, it doesn't have to be creative. It doesn't have to be brilliant. It is, don't try to be. Just write and fill 3 pages every day. And what that does, it starts connecting your thoughts to your creative thoughts and your writing to the process of writing. And just gets you into that habit and the discipline of writing every day as well. And that's half the battle. Hemingway was quite a prolific writer of fiction, but he had a habit, and he was a journalist. Every day, though, regardless of what happened, he would get up and write for 3 or 4 hours. So first thing he'd do is write. And he'd do that every day for 3 or 4 hours. Then he'd knock off, have lunch, and then get soused drinking. But you know, regardless if he was hungover, if he was sick, he would spend the first few hours of every day writing. Even if he knew what he was writing was going to be completely rubbish and he'd have to throw it out, he had that discipline. And so this morning pages taps you into that sort of discipline of just getting it out there on a piece of paper and not worrying about quality, not getting it right, just writing about what's happened during the day, writing about whatever comes to mind, and nobody's going to read it. You don't have to worry about grammar. This is just getting you in that writing habit. Really, really important process. I've known people who've done just that and have managed to write whole books. So it gets you started. It gets you moving. And that's the key thing from going from thinking, where a lot of you are, into actual writing. So those morning pages. The artist state is to nurture your creativity. And that is to go do something that you feel is nurturing your creative side, feeding your creativity. That might be to take a walk in the park. That might be to plant a bed of roses. That might be to go to the museum and look at art. That might be to go to a concert. But you need to feed your creative side, fuel that creative side. It doesn't have to, it could be you go and play with Play-Doh or get some finger paints or something. Take a pottery class or something, anything, but do something that will nurture your creativity. And it can be a different thing each week if you want. But once a week, take yourself out on an artist date. And I'd also recommend, in terms of tapping into creativity, your artist date might be a weekly massage. Getting relaxed, creativity is a function of two things, being relaxed and having space. Space and time. We don't give ourselves space and time to think because we're so busy. And creativity leaps forth when you give yourself that time to do that. Now, if you're an extrovert, you might prefer to join a writer's group and participate in a writing group and get the support of a group. So there's writer's groups all over the country, all over the world. Join in, and that will help you and give you some support in that group, a local group that you can see in person is ideal. And then there's also something called NaNoWriMo. And NaNoWriMo, you can Google it, is a commitment to write a massive number of pages in a very short period of time. So if you've been procrastinating about just getting words written onto a page, and it starts, in the fall, in September, October, so it's coming up. So you can get prepared for NaNoWriMo, and that's another way to support you in just getting it. Everybody's trying to reach this goal of X number of pages a day that you write and commit to. So just a massive writing project. So some people find that really helpful. Some people find that really stressful. So if it's too stressful for you, forget it. If it gets you into a group that's supporting you in writing and just getting some stuff on paper, because once it's on paper, you can then get people to edit it, and that's easier. And you could edit it yourself, but it's getting it down that first time. Okay? So those are some ways that you can get started. Now about the title. Don't worry too much about finding the title right away, but once you've got some ideas down and you start fleshing out some possible ideas for title, in fiction, you can have any wacky title you want, and it doesn't matter. In nonfiction, you need to have the right title and subtitle. And to select the right title, you actually need to understand about keywords. And keywords are words that people search for. So if you're writing a nonfiction book, it's about something, right? So I write books about coaching and life coaching and success. And so those key words for that book would be life coaching. And people would say, oh, I need a book about life coaching. That's what they would type into Amazon.com. And hopefully your book will come up for that. Now, I don't have... Because you're not, you know, I could be unknown author, and because Life Coach, somebody types that in, and my book might come up on Amazon, you could actually find me. So that's the great thing about having a specific topic, is that people can find you with your topic alone, if you use the right keywords. But if you come up with some clever title like Cows Are Purple, you know, that's not going to relate to your topic. It might be a catchy title, but there's no keywords in it. And so for the nonfiction title, you really need to think about what your keywords are that people will be searching for. And ideally, they should be in your title, and at the very least in your subtitle, so that when people can find you for the topic that they're looking for. So I know that sounds really boring, but much better to have your book be found, and especially as an unknown author, how are people going to find your book? And that's really the great thing about nonfiction as opposed to fiction, is that people can search for you and your topic. So the better your keywords are, the more likely they are to be searched for, the better chance that your book will come up on the radar. And it gives you a huge advantage as an author, because you can then compete against established authors because you've got the right keywords in your title. So really important to think about what those keywords are. Now, how do you find those out? There's a software program that's very hard to use, but it can help you. It's called Longtail Pro to help you find out what keywords are. And this is what people use to build websites as well. So if you're going to build a website for your book, you're going to need to know those keywords, certainly. It's what people search for on Google when they're looking for something. You can also use Google AdWords and try to find out what the keywords are and what's the most searched thing. And it's surprising. You find out, well, life coaching has 14,000 searches a month, and Life Coach has 22,000 searches a month, so I want to make sure I use the word Life Coach instead of Life Coaching. Crazy things like that. So that's what you'll learn when you start doing a little research on keywords. And it's worth, I know it sounds like a crazy thing to do, but it's really worth it, because you want your book to show up when people search for your topic. And that's the really important thing about nonfiction. All right? So worth doing some investigation on keywords and looking more into finding out what are the right keywords that you need to incorporate into your title and subtitle. Right. Descriptive is good. All right, so enough on the titles. We'll move on to the next slide, the book proposal. Now, this is another big difference with fiction and nonfiction. With a fiction book, you actually have to submit the entire, complete, written fiction book as a done item. Now, it doesn't mean it won't get edited, but you need to do the best you possibly can with the whole entire book and then give it out to an agent. With nonfiction, it's a different sort of thing. What they're looking for, what the publisher is looking for, they're looking to make sure that you can sell your own book. So basically, the book proposal is a marketing pitch. It is a proof that you can not only write the book because you do a great job on three sample chapters or and have an interesting outline and can do a good job of writing the proposal, but really the book proposal is more of a sales pitch than it is an actual book itself. So the book proposal, and can be a good thing. Your book proposal can be about 20 pages long. They're fairly substantial documents, but it's more of a sales pitch as to why your book is needed in this world, why this book is different from the competition. So in your proposal, you need to cover the other books that are out there that are similar to that. So if you're writing a book about Russian history, you need to say, well, here are the most popular Russian history books and their titles and authors. And this is why my book is different from these and has a unique perspective that people need to know. So you have to have read those other books about Russian history. You have to say why your book on Russian history is different and needed in the market and why there's a demand for this perspective out there. So include some sample chapters at the end, basically to prove that you can write and that you write well. But as well, you need to show them how you're going to sell your own book. And I know this is crazy, but publishers want to make sure that you have a platform. And a platform is your ability to sell this book. Because publishers don't want to lose money. They're hurting as it is in this world. And so they don't want to take a risk that your book won't sell. Now, the average nonfiction book sells around 7,000 to 8,000 copies. It's not a lot. That's pretty much the average. So they don't want to take a risk and spending the time and money to have an editor work on your book and publish it if it can't at least sell that many copies. So they want to make sure that you can sell that many copies so that they're not at risk. It's kind of the grim realities of this world is that people, I think, have expectations that they're going to sell millions of copies, and it's actually not usually the case for people. So to lower your expectations and be clear then on why you actually are writing the book. Is this to help your career, to help your business? Is it for fun for you? Is it something you want to do? Because it's a real business now, selling books. And the time to market your book, you're going to need to have a marketing plan. How are you going to sell your book? Is it because you're a professor and have a built-in audience of students and can sell because of your audience? So that's basically what a platform is. It's what's your audience. And without a platform, and this sounds really discouraging, but without a platform, it's difficult to get a publisher to buy your book. They already want to know that you're successful and that you already have an audience before you start your book. Again, fiction's different, but with nonfiction, they want to make sure, are you a speaker? Are you a blogger? Are you a journalist? Do you have a column in a magazine? If you do, that's your platform. That's the way you get exposure to people who will then buy your book. So you want to think about what your own platform is. And if you don't have a platform, you need to create an audience. And so while you're also doing this thinking about your book idea, you might just start toying around. Create a blog. Open a WordPress site. And start blogging about it. And if you can get some traction and some interest in your blog, then you'll build an audience. And then when you're ready to write your book, first of all, you'll already have written a lot of your book because these blogs could be turned into a potential book. But you'll also see if you have an audience. And you can either sell your book to your existing audience or at least prove to the publisher that there's some interest in this topic because you have thousands and thousands of followers. So that could be one way to create a platform for your own book if you're a speaker. Or if you're not speaking, you could start speaking about your topic before you even write your book and see. In fact, Julia Cameron, who wrote The Artist's Way, that book was after she'd already done multiple seminars on creativity. And so she was basically teaching people how to be creative and tap into their creativity first before she wrote the book and then used the book as kind of a way to say, these are the seminars I've been teaching, this is the information. So a lot of people do that, where they're trainers first, basically, and they're sharing their wisdom and information with people, and then they convert that into a book. So that could be your platform, that you have an audience of people who attend your seminars. So you could start doing seminars. and then you'll get stories for your book in that. So it's a good thing, too. And then, of course, you'll need some sample chapters. So you need to show them, you know, this is my audience. This is how many subscribers I have. This is how many people follow me on Twitter or LinkedIn. If, you know, so this is how many students I speak to or people. Or so you got to have an audience already. It comes before the book, not after. You hopefully you'll build on it once you have a book. But you start building your audience before you have the book. right? So that's something people don't realize, that they need to have an audience. Self-publishing, we can fudge a little bit on that, but nonetheless, you still have to think, how am I going to sell this book? And so that's what they want to know. Finding an agent is next. So now you've written your proposal, and there's some great books out there already on how to write the perfect book proposal. In fact, I think that's the title of it. Yeah, Write the Perfect Book Proposal by Herman and Adams. So it's called Write the Perfect Book Proposal. That is a really excellent book to use to write that proposal. And it tells you what needs to go into your proposal. It gives you sample proposals. It shows you people who've done proposals and why they didn't work and why they did work. It's a small book, but it actually has loads of information. So I recommend you get that book for the proposal writing piece. Next is to find an agent. And when I first wrote Coach Yourself to Success, I didn't know any of this that I'm telling you. I learned it all the hard way. I didn't know anything. I thought you had to write the whole book, so that's what I did. I didn't know you could just write a few chapters. I thought you just mailed your book to a publisher. So I mailed my entire manuscript to an editor at a publishing house, and the books came back to me, every single one of them, with a letter on top that said, "We do not accept unsolicited manuscripts." I thought, well, what's that? What do you mean you don't accept unsolicited manuscripts? I didn't even know what that meant. What that means is that they only accept agented manuscripts. That means they only accept a manuscript that was sent to them from an agent. And the reason that is because the agent is designed to weed out the wheat from the chaff, to select the good books. And the agent's there because they know what sells and what there's a market for. And the agent represents you and says, this is one of the good books. It's worth your time, publisher, to read it and take a look at this. But the agent pitches your books and says, yep, we've got a good one here. And not only that, but this author has a platform. We can sell this. So the agent ideally has already done that. So that's why you need an agent. If you're planning to get a publisher to publish your book, you need an agent. To get an agent, you send a letter of inquiry to the agent and say, oh, I've noticed. Now, here's the easiest way to find an agent. Your books that you read for your research, and this is why you need to do your research anyway, in the acknowledgments, people always acknowledge their agent and their editor. So you'll always find out if somebody acknowledges their agent. So let's say we're back on Russian history books, and you've read a number of these. You'll see the acknowledgments there to any agents or publishers in there and editors. And that can give you an idea then of who might be a good agent for your book. And you could say, right, and most agents have a website and they have a process of how you submit a proposal to them. And they'll tell you on their website what to do. Follow that agent's instructions to the letter. Don't just send the same thing to every agent. If an agent has a format for how you should submit their proposal to them and what they want from you, follow it exactly. Don't just send the same thing to everybody, because they may have a slightly different process. My agent is Bonnie Solo for my book, and she does nonfiction. She has a very precise process. She wants you to send a letter of inquiry first, and she tells you what should be in that inquiry letter. Basically, you tell briefly about yourself and about your book and how you think you can sell it in a very brief letter, and then you attach a few sample chapters in your proposal, and she tells you all about what you need to do. So if you go to her website, she's Bonnie Solo with New Media. She's now Solo Literary. Solo, S-O-L-O-W, Literary. Now, I'm not saying you should use her as an agent, because she might not be in your topic, but at very least, she has a nice outline on how to do an inquiry letter and what that should look like. So you send that inquiry letter to your agent and submit that first, and then if they're interested, they'll say, send your proposal. Okay? So that is the idea. Once your agent says, yeah, this is good, then they'll sell your book to the publisher and find the right home for you. And that solves you a big, huge problem. Hopefully your agent will be able to find a home for your book. It's no guarantee that they can, but you sign a contract with your agent that they represent you, and then they take a cut, 10 to 15% usually, of the book's sales. So they take that off the top, and then they send you the leftovers, the author. Okay? So if you can't find an agent, then you may need to start looking at self-publishing as an option. So the best way to find an agent is to read the books in your topic and see who acknowledges their agent as a good one. And that's a really great way. You a letter. That's even better than just sending out a straight inquiry letter. Okay. Next step then is to find a publisher. So your agent will help you find the right publisher. They'll know the publishing business. They'll know the editors. They keep a good agent keeps on top of all that because it's a fast moving world now. Those editors change companies quickly and things change a lot and have changed a lot in publishing. So your agent will help you find that. If you don't have an agent, then you can try contacting. And sometimes the smaller publishing houses, you may contact directly. So depending on what your topic is, you might be able to contact some of these smaller houses directly. Again, looking at books and seeing who are the editors here and see if you can send a letter directly to the editor. You know, maybe you'll have some good luck. The big houses, the big house, my books are published with McGraw-Hill. The big houses don't take unsolicited manuscripts unless you have a connection. If your Aunt Sue knows the editor of HarperCollins, well, for heaven's sakes, use your connections. Don't be shy about that and say, then get your aunt to hand the book over to this person. You could try that. I would try anything that you can. So if you do happen to have any connections, by heaven's sakes, use them. And then the other option is self-publishing. So if you can't find an agent or a publisher and you've tried some of the smaller publishing houses and that's not working for you, again, it takes a lot of persistence getting published, then you can move to self-publishing. And that, again, has never been easier. And this is why publishing houses are so difficult now to get into because it's so easy to self-publish. And that's thanks to Amazon. Amazon has a new authors program. And it's particularly helpful for the fiction writers. Fiction writers can thrive with their new author program. But I would look into that. And the other thing, even without the new authors program, which is really geared more toward fiction, with the nonfiction on Amazon, you can write and self-publish a book and get it on Amazon. And then it's all down to those keywords that I talked about. It's so important because as an unknown author, the only way people will find you is those keywords. If they're searching for Russian history, they're going to type in that as a keyword and then your specific topic. So the more specific your subtitle can be, so your main title would have to type in Russian history or something about that people would be searching for. Use those keywords. And that can have your book rank right up there with really established authors. And that's the amazing democracy now of the publishing world. And the challenge of it, too, because people are going to want to read the reviews and see, gosh, I've never heard of this person. Are they any good? All right, so self-publishing is a really viable option now, more viable than it has been in the past. The thing you have to watch out for, and I'm sure you've all experienced this, where you've bought books on Amazon that weren't by a publishing house, and they were really crummy, and there were typos, and it was cheaply produced. Be cautious of that. You know, if you're going to do this, do it right. You can get really good self-publishing houses now to get your book printed nicely. Hire an editor. If you aren't going to go through a house, you're going to need your own editor. Hire a proper editor. Don't just get your mom and dad to do it. Yeah, get your mom and dad to do it, and your brother and sister, and your friends. Get everybody to edit, and get a professional editor. It's so worth paying for because you've seen all those typos in the books, and it's really annoying, and we don't want you to have a bad reputation. So it's worth doing. Now we're coming up to promoting your own book. So whether or not you have a publisher or self-publish, you still need to promote and sell your own book. And that, I think, was the biggest eye-opener for me because I just thought, well, once you have a big publisher like McGraw-Hill, they'll do all your radio shows and your publicity and get you on TV and do all this. Guess what? They may not. They may not do anything. In fact, they're getting worse and worse because their own budgets have been cut, and they get worse and worse about putting people through tours and things. You pretty much need to plan on doing it yourself. So they might help you with a little bit of publicity. The things I get most help from nowadays are some, you know, they'll help out with like making postcards for you with your book cover on it, and or putting together some publicity for you and getting you in front of some media so you can have some interviews, hopefully, if you're lucky. But plan on doing that yourself so that you know you have your own way of promoting and selling your book. And like I said before, you already need to have an audience. And even if you're self-publishing, you're going to still need an audience because you now have to sell it yourself. The advantage of a publisher is that they can distribute the book to the stores. They can get it out there in the world. But if you're self-publishing, you have the distribution problem. And that's where Amazon comes in really handy because they can be your distributor. But you still need to build an audience. And so you still need to be out there in the world blogging, creating a presence. You need a website. You need to do speaking. You need to do some radio interviews. You may want to pitch your ideas to the relevant periodicals or magazines. So think about media outlets would be important for you. And then the very importance of your very own list, your list of fans, your list of subscribers, the people who've signed up to get news from you. So that could be your people who follow you on, I don't recommend Facebook because Facebook owns your list. So the problem with using Facebook is that you don't actually own your list of people who are following you. Facebook does. Whereas if you have an old-fashioned email subscription, I have on my website, lifecoach.com, and you can sign up and get my free coaching kit on there, and then you'll get into an email subscription where I kind of keep in touch with you by sending you coaching tips every week. And I've been sending people coaching tips now for years, and so I have thousands of subscribers on that list. And I own that list. Facebook doesn't own it. Those are my people, and I take care of them, and I don't sell that list. I guard that list because that's your gold. Your list is your gold. And when you write your second book, you let your list know. And you say, hey, people, I've written a second book. And those are the people who are most likely to rush out and buy it because they're your loyal fans. So you want to start nurturing and taking care of your fans now. And that might be and I do recommend, I mean, as much as you can use Facebook to let people know stuff, make sure you have your own list. And you can set up MailChimp. MailChimp is good for creating a list. And if you want to, you know, and then you can do mailings from that. So that's an easy tool to use and get set up to manage your own list. But those are your people. You protect them, you know, take care of them. Don't sell them to anyone. Those are your people. All right, but that's really important because that's you want to grow that list. And most people have a starting point of about 200 people in their network. That's the average starting point. So you want to grow your natural network to thousands, of course. And the bigger your list, the more likely you'll be able to sell your book. All right. Good. Well, gosh, we still have some time here, so we can open up the floor for any questions that people have. I'm sure you might have some questions. What do we have on the floor so far, Sarah?
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Talane. And we have some other information that I'll share as Talane is answering the questions and that you can look through later. Again, I am emailing a copy of the presentation deck to everyone along with a link to the recording so that you can go through this information again. So first question, do you risk giving away your book by writing on a blog regarding the same topic as your book, especially if it's a nonfiction topic?
Well, the thing is, it's a kind of a strange thing with the internet. People worry that they're giving away their best stuff on the internet by either putting it on their website or putting it in blogs. But if you're not known, you need to start sharing your information. And all the marketing experts will tell you, put your best foot forward. Because there's a lot, information is out there all over the place. And so people are going to be attracted to you because of the way you're expressing that, your way of sharing that information. And that's how you build an audience. And if you can't build an audience with a blog, then it's not likely you'll be able to build an audience with your book. So it's a good place to start and test your topic and see if there's any interest in your topic, if you can create some interest there. So don't be so afraid of that. The thing that will have, yeah, because some people say there's no new information. I mean, if you have some coveted piece of extremely valuable information, you should probably trademark it, patent it, copyright it. But most of the time, we're all sharing fairly stuff that's out there. The information is out there, but we're sharing it in a different way, in a way that captivates people. So, yeah, you could tease about your, I mean, there's an interesting website called howtostopyourdivorce.com. And it's a very simple website. He's basically this very convincing pitch. And then he doesn't tell you how, but he has a very convincing pitch on how to stop your divorce and assures you that he has the answers to it. And then you pay, I don't know, $79 or something, and then but he shares everything around that. But the general rule of thumb is, you know, start sharing some stuff about your topic. And yeah, you can keep a few gems hidden back, but generally people need to lead with their best foot forward because otherwise you won't be noticed. There's just so much information out there. It's a really good question. People tend to hide their good stuff instead of show it.
We have many questions around copywriting. Do you mm-hmm. need to worry about getting your work copyrighted? When should you create a copyright? And how do you create a copyright?
Copywriting is really easy. First of all, the moment you've written something on a page, technically it's copyrighted. But the problem is, how do you prove that? So the moment you've written anything on a piece of paper, it's copyrighted. But it helps if you actually put the date and the copyright and your name on it, you know, copyrighted by Talane Miedaner, or if you have a company by that company. Then it's officially copyrighted. But to prove that you were the first one to write that, what you can do is, so say you've written your book, you can mail it to somebody. I mailed it to my mother. So you go to the post office, you stick your book in there, and then you mail it with a seal. So it has to be sealed and dated, and the post office can do that for you. And then you don't open it. Tell your mom not to open it because you want that seal to be unbroken. Then if there's any idea that somebody's stolen your ideas or stolen your book, you have proof, and then the judge can open up your book that you'd mailed and with the date on it and see that, yes, this was your book. So that's an easy way to protect your ideas. Date them and copyright them. You can just, on your computer, you have a copyright symbol. You can use that. You don't even have to use the symbol, though, the little C with a circle on it. You can just write copyrighted in the date. You don't actually have to file for your copyright. So that's an easy way to just copyright things that you're doing now. To more officially copyright them, your publisher will file and actually keep the copyright for you and file the proper copyright. So for the moment, don't worry too much about that. Just put copyright on the bottom of your stuff and your name on it and the date. And that'll protect you for the time being. But the thing about copyright is this. If the burden of protection is on you, the author, or the publishing house. So, for example, people have taken my published books that are published by McGraw-Hill, photocopied them, and put them on the internet and let people either pay to download them or download them for free. And so constantly, what you need to do is use Google Alerts, and I put my name in, and thankfully I have a Talane Miedaner is not the most common name in the world. There's nobody else with my name. So I put Google Alerts for Talane Miedaner. And sure enough, almost once or twice a month, I get a notice from Google Alerts that somebody has copied my book, put it on the internet, and is selling it or letting it be free for people. It's a real pain in the nuisance. So I have to then alert my publisher and say, look, somebody's just done this. My publisher then goes after them. Their legal department says you have to take that down. But the author then has to track down. So you're responsible for monitoring the world and making sure that no one else is using your content. Thankfully, Google Alerts makes that fairly easy. But yeah, copyright. The other odd thing is titles can't be copyrighted. So you could take my title, and people have done this, which I don't like, but Coach Yourself to Success is the title of my first book. People can use that title in their book. There's no way I can protect them from that. So you could conceivably use the exact same title. Now, what that does, and your editor will discourage you from doing that, it creates confusion in the marketplace. So not only is it not original, but it does create confusion. But people have done it. So you actually can't copyright your own title, which is a bit bizarre, and why you'll see books with the same title out there. And it does create confusion in the marketplace. But people do it because somebody else has got a good reputation, and they're trying to hitch their star onto their wagon. yeah, it's not the best thing to do, but people do it. So that's why I recommend try to come up with an original title, but get the keywords in there. That would be your main thing.
Okay.
What other questions do we have?
While writing is important, it is important to have in mind who your audience is. So what are your tips for specifically identifying your audience and testing your
Well, this is why getting going with blogging, if you don't know who your audience is already, getting out there blogging, and you can use social media even for this. That's one of the good things about social media is you can start chatting with people and finding out what their interests are. So that can help you get to know what questions people have, what problems people have, what are their concerns. So you can have that's what's actually the best use, I think, of social media, is to start to understand the issues and problems of your audience and see if you can't solve them. And the nonfiction books often can be for that, solving people's problems or providing them information about some area that they need to know. And they're searching for that, and they have questions about that. So if you can figure out what their questions are, and then your book chapters could be answers to those questions. And you can have little blogs about it on your website and then say, for more information, read my book. And that's how you can leverage that. But start building up with some of the information. Maybe it's not all of the information, but it's some on your website, and you let people know in your book you have more. Any other questions?
And do you have recommendations on what you did to increase your marketing pitch around your first book?
The best thing, well, for my book, because it's in the field of coaching, seminars are absolutely the best way. And other people will tell you is that you can get in front of people and talk. It's a great way to get the word out. And if you look at people who are best-selling authors, they do a lot of speaking usually. So they're out there in the public, constantly going to book signings, creating events, doing seminars, speaking. So it really helps to be out there talking about your topic. And that creates your audience, which then is the audience that will buy your book. And although, of course, it's one of these catch-22s, to get paid more as a speaker and to get onto the speaker's list, it helps to have a book because that gives you authority and credibility. Sometimes you have to start just self-publish your first one, and then you might consider using a publisher. Actually, I recommend doing it almost the other way around. If you can get a publisher for your first book, I recommend it because there's so much to learn in the whole process of publishing. It's great because they'll hold your hand through the whole process and make sure you're doing it right. Then you'd be better geared to self-publish after that because you know more about the whole process of writing the book and then what goes into it and what's required of that. So if you can get published first, then I'd recommend that. And then maybe your other books you could self-publish because self-publishing is hard work. Getting a book done with a publisher is hard work. And self-publishing is even more hard work because you're doing everything yourself. So much harder, really. But for a lot of people, that's the way to start. I know Shakti Gawain, who wrote the book called Creative Visualization. That was a pamphlet. And she used to run around with this pamphlet and take it to bookstores. And she said, oh, can I sell this? And she'd sell it off the back of her car. And she was talking and doing seminars. And that book became a bestseller. And then it's a very tiny, tiny little book. But it became a bestseller because she was out talking, and then the publishers picked it up when it was already being sold. Somebody said, wow, we're selling a lot of these pamphlets. Maybe we should publish this. And so, you might start off with just a very short book, a pamphlet, and that could become successful. Especially now you can use the Internet. That was pre-Internet that she was successful. But you still need to get out there and get your audience. And word of mouth and speaking is the best way to do that.
Well, that's a perfect key up to the next question. How can people go out there and find speaking engagements if they are not Hillary Clinton as this alum?
Yeah. My inspiration was Tony Robbins. I read in his book that he started speaking in his New York City apartment for free to friends and family. And he'd do free stuff to start. And that was the beginning of his speaking career. I thought, well, Tony Robbins now was making, at the time, $80,000 for one keynote speech. I thought, well, if that's how he started, that's good enough for me. So I started speaking in my apartment in New York City, which was a one-bedroom apartment. People were sitting on the bed with friends and family. So I'd invite friends to a potluck supper, and I'd say, bring your favorite food and your favorite friends. And I called the workshop Life by Design. And we said it was a three-hour workshop. I did on a Sunday night from 6 until 9. We took a break for food and a break for – we ate first because you can't compete with – I was looking for speakers. So you'll be speaking for free probably at first. There's a wonderful book that I recommend on speaking. It's called Speak and Grow Rich by Dottie Walters. Speak and Grow Rich. And she tells you exactly how to start your speaking, how you can get your first gigs, how you can start getting paid, what a speaking contract looks like. But you might start out with sort of doing the chicken dinners for the local Kiwanis Club, and going to talk to them about your Russian history book or whatever it is. So you could start with the Kiwanis and do your free talks and get your free chicken dinner, that kind of thing. That's how most speakers start. I did my potluck suppers and had people brought their friends who I didn't know, and that expanded my audience from beyond my own friends to new people, which is what you want to do. You want to expand your audience beyond your current network. And it was free. So you could speak in churches. One coach I know, she started this, Cheryl Richardson, now a best-selling author, again in the coaching field. She started having coaching gatherings, and at her local church, she was able to rent the room for a very small amount, use that as a monthly gathering of people. She'd offer tea and some cookies, and people would come after work, and she would talk for 20 minutes on the topic and then open it up for open networking. And she did that once a month and started with three, four people, and then it grew to be a very large group. And she's now a best-selling author, which she got onto Oprah early on, so that helped. And has sold countless books, and I think she's written about 5 books. So, again, starting with these little tiny things, very low cost in the local community. Tony Robbins started for free in his apartment. So people think they start off being on TV. No, you start off in some basement of a church.
Or on a Georgetown alumni webinar.
That's right.
But, all right, so what is better, to blog or get an email list? And if both, why? And should content be the same on different email lists versus the blog?
Well, I would say, you can do, I don't know that when it's, it probably depends on your audience and your topic. You know, older audiences like email better. Younger audiences tend to like the social media better and use Facebook almost as a form of media. Problem with, beware of anything that you don't own your own list. That's all I would say. So if you're blogging on your own website, that's fine, but you want to catch their emails. So that means you want them to subscribe to your blog and get their emails and then receive them via email. So you want to catch people's emails. That's the point. How you do that, I don't care. Any which way you can, you want to start capturing people's emails. Obviously, you need to have an unsubscribe on there or it's spam. You can't just take people's emails and put them in your thing. But you want to start creating your list. That's of utmost importance. And you can use your social media to get people from social media onto your list. But remember, the key thing is to start building your audience and your list. So whichever way works for you, different people and different audiences respond to different things. But just be aware that Facebook owns your list, not you. People spend a lot of money building stuff on Facebook only to find that they don't own anything and they don't control it. So watch out. I don't recommend that. Yes, you can use Facebook for other things, but beware that that's not your only list.
No. And we'll close on this question. Do you have recommendations on how much time to allot to your writing each week if you have a full-time job and competing commitments?
Well, most people have full-time jobs and competing commitments, so most of us don't have time. So you might want to look at what you can cut out of your life. Now, the easiest thing is to find out when you're a writer. Are you a morning writer? Is that when your creativity sparks? Are you fresh and bright and ready to go? Good. Use the mornings. Get up an hour earlier. Start going to bed an hour later. Go to bed an hour earlier so you can get up. I'm getting strong. Go to bed earlier so you can get up earlier in the morning and still get your sleep, because it's no good trying to write when you're tired. But you need your sleep. Plus, during our we get ideas at night. Your brain's working on concepts while you're sleeping, so you want to leverage that and get your full amount of sleep. And do that at your prime time. Some people are night owls, and they are better writing at 2 a.m. in the morning. So you need to find out what your writing time is. You probably already know. But then set that aside as sacred. And I'd say the minimum would be half an hour. But if you start with your 3 pages a day right now, that's a great place to start. For those of you, most of you are in the thinking stage, just get into that 3 pages of morning pages, not even about your topic, is great. I had a colleague, she wrote a book, she had 3-year-old son. She had half an hour a day to write, and then she was exhausted. She'd write after work when she finished her work as a journalist. In 1 year, writing half an hour a day, she had finished a full book and got it published. So you can, even with half an hour a day and a small 3-year-old son, you can still do it. Not easy, but it can be done. So if you can give your actual writing of the book half an hour a day, you can do it. If you can give it more, all the better.
All right, wonderful. And you'll see at the...
Yeah, go ahead.
Go ahead, Talane.
I was just going to say, your morning pages. If you do nothing else, do that.
Okay. And as you'll see here, there are plenty of ways to stay in touch with Talane. I will send this presentation deck to everyone so they can click through, but you can follow her on those mediums. And then I wanted to show everyone this special partnership that the Georgetown Alumni Association collaborated with Talane on starting last year. If you all are writing your book and also wondering what you want to do with your life and you think you need a career change, you can sign up for this very in-depth assessment, and we're offering it at a special rate to Georgetown alumni, thanks to Talane, so you won't find the offer anywhere else. So if you're looking for something new, go on the website or go to lifecoach.com/Georgetown Career Change, and you can learn more or contact Talane to get some feedback there. And I will also be sure to send you the link to Talane's upcoming webinar. She'll be doing an open coaching session. So the entire webinar will be focused on answering questions related to career change. So you'll be able to just type in whatever you'd like, and we'll spend a ton of time on Q&A. And we also have a virtual networking event coming up for our Hoya writers. So that's a way that you can continue this discussion with fellow Hoyas, and not Talane, unfortunately. Well, Talane, maybe you should sign up, but you can speak to others who are in the writing process and just bounce ideas off of one another. So I'll send information on all of those events. Talane, anything you want to add before we close out?
Yeah, just, you know, I had left my job in the banking world to start coaching and did that whole transition. And I can tell you, if you're thinking that you haven't tapped into your full potential, that there's something better out there for you to do, I'll tell you right now, you are right. There is. So don't think that those thoughts aren't serious. They are. If you're having thoughts of that there's something better for you, there probably is, and we can help you find it. So I just want to encourage you. I was in that place, and it's much nicer on the other side, doing what you love to do. That's it. I look forward to being in the open coaching session and helping people with whatever questions you have. It should be a lot of fun.
Okay. All right. Thank you so much, Talane, and have a wonderful rest of the week, everyone. Hope you're all in some air conditioning. Bye.
Yeah. Good luck with your writing.
Yes. Good luck. Bye.
Bye-bye.